like this movement here from him.
Yeah, that is called sweet, sweet victory, my friends. That would be Chrissy on the Bat Rider twirling that mustache going, yeah, so predictable, my little peons. Yes, right into my hand. Mid lane, it'll be exclamation man, the Razor, purple, whatever you want to call him. Could be anyone. Down bottom, uh-oh, Ghost. He could be in some trouble. But Living Armor comes out, and he'll be able to gallop his way to safety as he makes it through that bottom room. So we'll be J.O. bottom on the position one Spectre. Ryo going to be on the Disruptor here, and that puts a cast on the Vengeful Spirit. So we got these two supports down bottom, and maybe they'll start roaming around a bit. But Centaur taking that pressure is a victory for Rave, as now the tree has skilled up Living Armor level 1, so no Leech Seed, but he didn't even have boots. He's just got two Clarities, so none of this super aggressive PPD-style Leech Seed First Blood tree coming out.
Yeah, and I'm going to call Razor Mr. Swish, just because that's the name that he has at the top of his Steam account. It's not an alias, but it's something. So I think I've heard that name before a couple times before in games, so it's the best we've got as far as putting a name to a face here. But anyways, he's going to be doing okay against the Exhort Invoker. Not as much as I'd like. He didn't go for the boots first, but went for the Wraithband build, so although that makes his general last hitting more consistent, it doesn't allow him to go for the Static Link steal, so it shows that he wants to be much more passive on this mid lane. He doesn't expect to be able to contest this Invoker because he thinks maybe the Treant, maybe the Rubick are roaming in, and that could be dangerous for him. But I honestly think just boots instead of Wraithband, you man up on this guy, you take his Link, you take his damage via the Static Link, and you're going to be able to control the lane much better. But in this case, it's better safe than sorry for him. And yeah, he will lose out on the CS war as a result.
Yeah, quite heavily. For Rave, the only one farming real well is that Spectre. J.O.'s in free farm heaven down bottom, as there's not a hell of a lot the Centaur can do about it. Looking at Dire Vision, he doesn't have too much. Does have a ward down here, so has a little bit. But oh boy, look at this Sentry Ward. It's just fallen short of it. They had an idea, and well, it's the right idea, but unfortunately just not executed quite to perfection. So that'll make Centaur's life a little easier in terms of avoiding death, but getting farm or slowing down the Spectre, well, not so much. He's level 2, and will intercept the easy camp, maybe get a last hit on one of these Harpies. Yep, finds a little bit of gold there. There's his first CS. Finds something, but these other lanes not really going so hot. Invoker nearly doubling the Razor. And up top, that Ember Spirit farming very well. Batrider in a similar situation to the Centaur.
Yeah, and J.O. just saying, okay, I feel too slow in this here. I'm going to pick up Phase Boots as my first pickup. Also allows him to last hit very nicely here. So he doesn't go for the Poor Man Shield early. Does mean it's going to be blocking less damage, but in general, he's still going to be able to get a lot of value out of these Phase Boots, chase a little bit, and he's going to go for a Max Desolate build, which is pretty appropriate in this case. He'll probably leave Dispersion at level 1, so he'll go 4-4-1-1. And that'll allow him to get into the fights pretty early on, before the Centaur has Blink at the very least.
Mm-hmm. Well, Treant now finds his level 3, also picks up Boots as his first item, so gets that first level on Leech Seed, but we're already starting to see the tail end of that window where Leech Seed is real scary with Boots on Tree. Yeah, it still is a pretty potent slow, does a bit of damage, but everyone's just a little tankier now, leveled up a bit, and awkward rotation from Ghost as he's just hanging out mid. Leech has a little bit of experience, or at least thinks about it. Invoker says, listen, Brad, you're going to have to get out of here. This is my lane. I need experience just as much as you do, friend. And perhaps looking for a kill on this Razor, but not going to be easy. Just on Brown Boots, I'm not really sure how he plans on initiating this one.
Leech Seed getting in range would probably be their best bet. Right now, Razor is still not running boots and doesn't have a single point in Unstable Current, but they won't be able to get the Treant in range, and yeah, as you said, Centaur's just going to have to make his way back to the bottom lane. He will find a decent wave of experience here. It's actually a pushing wave from J.O. It looks like he wanted to punish the fact that the Centaur was away by going ahead and just burning down this tower, but Ghost comes in just in the nick of time to pick up all this juicy experience, and he is going to be finding not only level 3, but closing in on level 4.
Yeah, smoke rotation now from Invasion. ADTR and OK will head towards the mid lane, and it looks like they'll try to put this level 3 Rubick with 2 points in Fade Bolt to good use as Mr. Swish. Better watch out, Razor. You might have a bottle, but you still don't have boots, and you are susceptible to these ganks. But look at this positioning. This creep shove into the tower. He backs on up, holds his high ground, and old Swishy here, he'll stay safe at least for now. Smoke gonna expire in a couple of seconds. Will get revealed by the Razor. He's gonna walk right into it. Telekinesis into the Leech Seed. Throws out the Plasma Field. Batrider's coming in, trying to rendezvous with his friend. Rendezvous successful as Haunt from the Spectre helps break it up. Instead, they're going on to, okay, First Blood drawn by Jaya. And it's a disastrous situation for Invasion as they end up handing over our First Blood to the Spectre. Nice call from Jaya there to use the Haunt and come on in, get a couple of charges on that Urn of Shadows.
Yeah, and he gets a clarity from his ally, so he's no worse off than he was just moments ago, but he's so much better. I mean, the First Blood gold, just feeling him more than any couple of creep waves could have given him. And as you mentioned, the earn charges, that allows him to sustain against the Centaur. You can double-edge this guy three times, and he's still going to be keeping on the lane. This is so much HP sustainability for him. So he's just going to be perfectly fine to free farm for a long time, and Invasion are going to have to commit a lot of resources to start trying to shut him down. I mean, you try to just win out the farm game and try to spread the map and do better things away from the Spectre, but when you just fed him a First Blood, you can't do that anymore. You have to look at it and say, okay, now he's gonna get big, and they're about to get a second kill on him. The Centaur is getting flanked hard. I love this smoke movement from Rave, and they are gonna be able to bring down Centaur again.
Yeah, Vengeful Spirit connects with the missile, and that's going to be more than enough damage to bring him down. Jaya taking tower shots. Whoa. FCFC comes on in. Searing Chains will bring down the Spectre as he fire remnants forward. Now Ryo in a bit of trouble. Okay, we'll telekinesis and pulls him back. It's a double kill for the Fire Bastard. And Vengeance will be found for Invasion. Now ADTR goes in on the cast, hits him with a Leech Seed. But I'm not sure what the Treant's going to be able to do here. Looks like cast will be just fine, just does a bit of damage. And that will be the end of it. So recovery, boys, as they say, as Invasion, make it worth the time of the Ember Spirit.
Yeah. It's worth noting that FCFC actually got glimpsed back there from his TP, but he dropped down a remnant right before then, so he was able to jump right back into it. The glimpse is completely useless against FCFC if he has the mana to sustain another Activate Fire Remnant and has the right position on it. So, yeah, very nicely done. Now we see the rune attempt from Mr. Swish. Not going to be successful. In fact, he's probably going to go down.
Yeah, he's in big trouble. In comes the Haunt from Spectre, though. They'll bring down the Treant to get things started. Now Chains out on Chrissy. That'll be a one-for-one to get it started, but they're going hard on the Ember Spirit. Lots of right clicks coming his way, and the Razor secures the kill. Is okay, looks for the rune, gets the bounty, but it's a one-for-two. And again, Rave, turn it around. And it's like that first fight all over again. About 1,000 net worth change in their favor. Spectre now with an Orb of Venom and moving into a Drum of Endurance has all these great initial items with just the casual bracer for now, and his damage output is adding up. 2 points in Desolate, going for that value 35 extra pure damage, and now getting some points in that Spectral Dagger.
Yeah, in this sense, like, it's all about the fact that the Centaur doesn't have Stampede. If without Stampede, Invasion can't maneuver against Rave, and they're just being absolutely destroyed if they get baited into a bad spot. Jo, like, stacks up 4 earn charges there, puts one on the Fleeing Razor, puts one on himself, and yeah, he is in a really good spot to just continue sustaining. But the big deal here is that Rave is fighting very intelligently. They're fighting with their Haunts. If they were trying to fight in between the Haunts where Spectre doesn't have the ability to throw out this big ultimate, get a lot of Desolate hits and jump to and fro within the fight, then they would be having a lot more issues. But as it stands, they're up against a lineup that doesn't have Stampede yet, and they're just making the most of this Haunt. So very, very inspired. And again, it puts more pressure on Invasion to make something happen down bottom. They're smoking up with Rubick and with Treant, but these are level 3 and 4 supports. With some TP rotation, it could be more kills for the Spectre. We'll have to see.
Yes, sir. And Invasion still smoked up. Plenty of time left on it, and they will not go for it. Instead, they'll back up and seem to rotate towards the mid lane. Batrider spent a little time in the jungle trying to get that Blink Daggers up sooner rather than later, sitting on Tranquil Boots, 1,500 gold, doing much better than the Centaur on that front, who has about 1,500 gold, but no Tranquils. That'll be the big disparity there as Jo grabs the Bounty Rune, and oh, Jo, it's going to be a sandwich. They'll find him, walks right into the telekinesis, and will get sent back with the Haunt. The fast trigger finger will keep him alive, and instead they'll turn it around up top. He will still end up going down as Centaur finishes him off, uses the Stampede to close the gap. Batrider, lasso on the Ghost, and in comes the Disruptor. They'll find the kill onto the Centaur, but it will cost them their bat, and it'll be a 2-for-1. 2 cores go down on the side of Rave for just a kill on the Centaur. A noble effort with the Haunt, but unfortunately not quite enough. Coming in onto the Ember Spirit. They're actually going to dive this. Out comes the Static Storm. 3 heroes rotating in. The Silence, not quite enough.
Wow.
Magic Missile's there. And Mr. Switch, does he have the damage? Living Armor will be enough to keep FZFZ alive. As OK does survive also. And Razor dives the tower, rotates back to rendezvous with his team.
Yeah, that was actually a very interesting approach with the kinetic static. You usually don't go for that play because it doesn't seem like it's going to work, but it almost paid off for them. They got a very good movement there with the disruptor, and Ember Spirit just barely gets out of that. The glimpse play and the kinetic, it's definitely frustrating him in these team fights. It's not actually killing him, it's not preventing him from fully doing what he wants to do, but it is inhibiting him to a significant degree. He's not going to have all the mana to play around with and so on. But yeah, still the pickoff is real on Jayo. That's that. Pickoff went straight to the Centaur Warrunner, and now when he was neck and neck with this blink race between himself and Batrider, now he's only 100 gold off. Like, he's doing so well off the back of that Spectre pickoff.
Yeah, big recovery for Ghost, and speaking of recovery, boys, they'll go down bottom and try and pressure this Spectre once more. Radiant have an Observer down, so FCFC has been scouted out, and with that, Jayo will back up and position himself appropriately as the not get jumped by the Ember Spirit. Drum of Endurance will be the item of choice next for the Spectre, so continuing on with this fighting build as we were talking about. Sometimes you'll see a Spectre kind of do this with a casual bracer and just look towards the Radiant's rush. Here we go, Stampede, Big Brad sounds the charge. He'll go in onto Jayo, but takes a lot of return damage. Sunstrike on the mark, Fiery Bolas bring down the Spectre, and it's a one for one, Centaur for Spec. Buyback Haunt, though, they'll go in onto ADTR. That secures a kill there, a double for Cast. Now they'll make a sandwich onto FCFC. Chrissy bumps right into him, there's the lasso, but Searing Chains get started. He'll get glimpsed back, and, well, Batrider ends up being a bit of a feed. Now the kinetic field stops the Ember Spirit dead in his tracks, gets off some bolas, but doesn't keep him alive. And Rave will eventually clean it up, but we'll look at the net worth change on that teamfight recap. And we'll just barely be a positive gain here for Team Rave by about 250.
Yeah, it's worth noting that Spectre actually lost 529 gold off of that. Despite getting the comeback assist, it's still the fact that she bought back in the first place. It does cost her quite a bit, and she'll just have to go right back to farming to find that drum very shortly. But still, I mean, keeping activity across the map here, they're not letting Invasion just get free money. The big deal there was that Sunstrike, 4 points in it, doing 287 pure damage is what can shift the team fight in your favor across the map. And that Spectre going down early forced Rave's hand, I think. I think if Jayo had just survived via Sunstrike, that would have been great, but we do see Mr. Swish getting picked as well. Ghost really making the use of that Blink Dagger, seeing as he is one of two heroes that has it on the map. Just that mobility advantage allows him to engage, even without committing ultimates and find kills.
Yeah, that cute little pickoff in the mid lane will yield a tier 1 tower kill in favor of Invasion, and they'll have the Forge Spirits to finish it off. That'll be Ketchikimba getting some bonus gold under his belt. Already has that Hand of Midas, picked it up a while ago with the Staff of Wizardry, and now 2,700 gold. And going to be near that point of just stacking up that Necro Book sooner rather than later. We'll see Invasion invading the Radiant Jungle, living up to their name here as Batrider has his Blink Dagger top, but they'll just take some of the neutrals, grab the Bounty Rune for the tree, and not going to be able to find much else of it as Rave are positioned very, very cautiously. And just look at this bottom tier 1 tower. Jayo as well as Ryo just like as deep in the trees as possibly can be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're trying to hide it out, but in the end, if they get found, there's so much jump potential from Invasion here. The ward comes out just a moment too late. Jayo is able to get out. They ping him at the last second, but they're like, ah, he's too far gone. Maybe they'll be able to pick up the Disruptor, though. Rior's in a really awkward position here. But yeah, right now it's going to be an attempt to defend this tower. We'll see how it plays out.
Yep, Glyph has re-upped itself after that previous tier 1 tower kill in the mid lane, so they've got this advantage there as Chrissy, Firefly on, looking for the blink over the tree line to initiate, but won't find an easy target, and will just try to wrap around the side. Now comes in, does get off the lasso. Chrissy, not the play you were looking for, friend. Out comes the ultimate from the Centaur. Vengeful Spirit taking a lot of damage as FCFZ gets silenced, just barely lives. Off to the side, the Rubick will fall to the Disruptor. FCFZ will TP home, and it is a 1-for-2 trade. Even with that abysmal start for Rave, with the Batrider hopping into his death, Invasion will not find the better out of the exchange. And with that, actually won't back up. They'll continue to press forward despite having a 3-versus-4 advantage or disadvantage on the field. They'll find the Razor, who's isolated as his team are nearby in the jungle. They get the jump on the Razor, and all of a sudden it's an even trade. They'll go in onto Ryo, and Jayo going in onto Ketchik. He spent his gold, so even if he goes down here, minimizes his losses. But still a lot of money going to Jayo, who finds a double. FCFZ finds vengeance for the fallen comrades and will give him the fire. Now looking for the Disruptor, will continue to chase him down. and should be able to find a kill here fairly easily. Rubik does manage to finish off the Ventral Spirit. There's the slight to secure the kill. A triple for FCFC, now lassoed into tower range. Flame Break doing some extra damage. OK's there, telekinesis back to create some space for his friend. And it may be enough. Blink forward from the Bat Rider, but doesn't want to commit as Living Armor flies through. So a very chaotic fight, but after that, it is Invasion that ends up ahead. And they will take the most significant lead we've seen this game of about 3,000 gold as they move in to finish off this Tier 1 tower once and for all.
Yeah, I think they just dive on this thing. They need this Tier 1 tower as quickly as possible before more TBs come. And FCFC, two right clicks, he gets it. And that is the huge bounty they're coming for. Now 3,200 gold in FCFC's Ember Spirit. And he's able to just catapult forward towards that Battle Fury. And yeah, he's going to have it very, very soon as a result of that fight completely. Now we're going to see some movement from Rave with the smoke. They're looking for a play maybe on the top lane, but they have to realize that they're not indestructible anymore. Like, going up against things like Forge Spirits and Necronomicon Warriors that have been able to survive throughout the entire fight already chips away at their health, and it leaves a lot of room for heroes like Ember Spirit and Sundar to just go in and finish the job. So we'll see. Right now, a smoke movement from Invasion won't come up to much, but they will be able to respond with the Stampede and make a TP rotation to help out catch a Gimba.
Yeah, he's in some trouble though. Sort of tanky, but just not tanky enough. Gets off the Necronomicon units and the Forge Spirits. So we'll have some extra damage to lay into J.O. as he gets caught inside of the bolas. The swap from the Venge, a noble effort, but not going to be enough. It'll end up being a quick double for the Ember Spirit. Now Chrissy, lasso onto the high ground as ADTR in an awkward position. Gets off an overgrowth on two, dies to the tower, but they find Mr. Swiss. They'll turn him into Swiss cheese as they chop him down. Centaur ends up getting taken out by a flame break to the face, and after some chaos, it will finish as a 3-for-3, but I would coin that a victory for Invasion as they finish off the Spectre, and they basically lost their Invoker before that fight started, so they make the keen recovery, and on the graph, it'll be about a break even.
Yeah, winning Haunt fights just with Stampede alone is a really big deal for the side of Invasion here, and they are suppressing J.O. significantly. He'd love to just be free farming away, but this fight, he actually dies towards the beginning of it rather than being able to DPS through the middle, and that is absolutely immense. The Ember Spirit's going to be able to find the Battle Fury very, very shortly. Actually has it on the courier now, and J.O. doesn't really have anything. The phase boosts the drums, like, he gets 411 movement speed when he has phase active, so he could pursue with his own hero a little, but the phase active can't apply to his illusions, obviously, so the Haunt illusions are still going to have trouble staying on their targets, and they're not really that tanky at 1200 HP. You know, obviously they take double damage, so yeah, I gotta say right now, J.O.'s not that big of a threat. Like, he's not moving towards Radiance all that quickly. He's got some good items to fight with, but Ember Spirit's just got him beat.
For now, at least. At least he's picked up that farming tool, and Spectre nowhere near a Radiance. Only 1,800 gold, still 2k off the Relic. And I think it's a smart play from Invasion in general, just to stay aggressive here. Continue to knock down towers to get map control, but sort of like you were pointing out, forcing J.O. to take fights, and he will not go for the Radiance. Instead, he moves into a Yasha, so picking a fighting item here, but not going to help him tank up, and not really sure how much the Yasha will help him in these upcoming skirmishes, though he does now have quite a bit of movement speed, near 450 when he pops those phase boots.
This is the exact build that just got nerfed in 6.82c. I honestly think, like, it's worse now to go this build than ever before, so very awkward. Ketchigamba and ADTR are going to be able to, with Forge Spirits and Necronomicon, finish off Roshan right when his Midas is going to come up, so he gets an Aegis, he gets a huge infusion of golden experience, and he's just going to keep that ball rolling. But yeah, I mean, the Yasha and Manta, the phase boots, the drum, his illusions aren't going to be still doing that much. They got nerfed really hard, the 30% to 40%. I mean, that's nerfing a quarter of their damage output, and building up the Yasha to try to make up for all this movement speed loss, it's okay. It used to be really good, and now it's quite so. Like, the Radiance, I think, is where it's at, and yeah, he's not going to be finding that this game, I don't believe. I mean, if you don't buy it now, then whenever will you buy it?
Yeah, I think that's definitely a good point. The Manta, good against the Treant, of course, but
yeah.
Doesn't really strike me as the best Manta game. There isn't like a core silence that you're trying to deal with, and yeah, I agree. I think the Radiance is still just a lot better, but they will lose their top tier one tower as Invasion continue the five-man deathfall, and that'll be the end of the outer towers. It is 3-0 on that front. We'll see Rave start to group up in the mid to pressure this tower, but They don't really have much pushing prowess, and if they end up going tower for tower, it will be a two-for-one trade. Of course, they do have a glyph, but the Dire actually don't. They have Living Armor, which does buy them some time, and already Rave are rotating to get in position to make a defense. But with this level 3 Necronomicon and the Forge Spirits,
Chrissy!
Chrissy hops in, gets telekinesis right away, will go down before he can even lasso. Stampede utilized as the Haunt flies forward, they bring down the Disruptor. Exclamation man, Mr. Switch, he's taking heavy damage, the Fiery Sword chops him down, a quick 3-for-0! Oh no, it's gonna be a full team wipe here, Blaze! Jao's in trouble, all 5 go down! Oh god.
Oh my gosh, FZFC just slicing and dicing. This is chop suey. Like, I don't know, Rave are in such a desperate position, but FZFC just shows what a hero can do when he really comes online with a core item. Rave, they don't have anything like that right now. The initiation from Batrider was really, really poor. Going in before anybody was ready and able to be counter-initiated on hard. I mentioned that you can do that with the Centaur, but you could sure as hell do that with the Rubick too. And just taking them and picking them apart 100%. I'm not even sure if they can hold Rax here.
Yeah, they will bring down the tier 3 tower, and seems like they wanted to back up, but they'll go for the ranged barracks. The sure damage as the Forge Spirits go in, and there are your Searing Chains on two. Lasso's available, FCFC will be isolated, and that'll be an Ember Spirit to go down, but they get a kill on the Venge. He'll buy back. Does he have a Remnant on the ground? He sure does. Already rejoined the fight. It's a 5v4 on the field, and they're not done yet. Now Chrissy caught inside of the Searing Chains. It'll be another kill on the Batrider. They'll lose their Centaur again, but Mr. Swiss. That's right. Swiss cheese, ladies and gentlemen, gets chopped once more, and good call on these barracks, Blaze, as they lose their range, and the melee soon to fall, as they've only got two alive, and maybe soon to be one. Ryo, Sunstrike will miss, but they should have the right clicks to finish him off. One more from the Rubick, might not even need it. The urn will be enough to bring him down. It's just Jao. He finds a return kill onto the Rubick, but not enough to hold the barracks. An invasion, now with a damn big lead of 10,000 gold, 7,500 experience, and quite a few new items to boot.
This is just really difficult for Rave now. They're digging themselves into a very deep grave with the progression they've had thus far, and losing out on this Rax, they're going to be constantly feeling the momentum, the pressure. I mean, Ember Spirit is usually a hero that rebounds on the defensive, but in this case, able to siege away just with the momentum he's built using his skills expertly. FCFC has been the man this game, just absolutely landing the Searing Chains whenever it counts, and yeah, obviously doing a lot of work as soon as that Battle Fury came out, just really racking up the kills, 14, 3, and 7. Like, I mean, I kind of feel that speaks for itself, but he's actually going to go back for a BKB here. I think it's a really good item against the Disruptor, but it is kind of lackluster against Batrider and Venge. We saw how great the lasso was at bringing him down. Luckily, he did have the buyback and the Activate Fire Remnant available, so was able to jump back into it, and you can only lasso once in a fight, pretty much, until that refresh orb comes out, Chrissy. He's got a long way to go before he's feeling good.
Honestly, I feel like some of that from the Ember Spirit, it's like, well, I've got to figure out what I want to deal with here. And so far, Batrider's performance has been lackluster. Let's be honest about it. He's been blinking in, lasso at the ready, and oh man, I'm not in position. And seems like more than half of these team fights, at least, he's hopped in and died before his team has really done anything. So if I was the Ember Spirit, I'd be feeling pretty okay about grabbing a BKB against this Batrider who can cut through it and just be safe against all the stuns and all the other magic damage that the team can put out. So I can see where FCFC is coming from here. And he actually does have it complete, but it's just hanging out. Oh, no, he doesn't have the recipe quite yet, but he's close. And now a Blink Dagger on the tree, and ADTR getting into the luxury items as he'll have that long-range initiation.
Yeah, well, we'll see pretty much the last stand from Rave here. Like, they're fighting outside their base. They obviously know that they need to make something happen before they get anywhere near the tier 3s, but top wave is pushing in. So the time hit bomb is ticking. Jao's looking to kind of farm that up on the top lane and then immediately jump into the fight. But ATTR, I think he wants to get the jump. If he can get a good blink overgrowth, this fight's over before it begins. And yeah, they just need to pick off one hero, and suddenly Rave are just scrambling to try to survive.
Chrissy comes in, gets off the lasso this time, but there's the counter initiation. Tree hold on 4. That sets it up. Now the follow-up is there. The hammer's going to be dropped. FZFZ's gone down. They find kills on 2. Batrider buys back to get into the fight. Jao will go down. Ketchikin, but uses the BKB to much avail. Chrissy, the lone survivor. He's already died once. Will it be twice? No. He'll live to tell the tale, but 1 for 4 plus a buyback. Yeah, I think Invasion will be happy with that one, Blaze.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the game breaker right there. A 3-man hoof stomp into a 4-man overgrowth. You just don't come back from that kind of a play. Invasion already had this massive lead. And they might not be able to fully break through the fact that one of their main damage dealers is down for the count, 40 seconds. And obviously, he bought back earlier. But they have Ketchikimba, who has gone for this push-oriented build. He's got Max Exhort. He's actually running Wex right now, I'm not sure why, but he does have Necronomicon coming in 40 seconds, and he has the Ford Spirits now. So the Force of Fortifications, the Chip of the Tier 3, and the Walk Away just that much better off with all these bounties coming their way.
Mm-hmm. They certainly will, and at this point, the lead getting pretty damn sizable, up to about 16,000 gold, 12,000 experience, and... sure, they don't get the dieback on the Batrider, and they lose their Ember Spirit. That slows down his BKB just a little bit more, so it doesn't quite have the recipe, but now the Invoker. Ketchik is just huge. Before that fight, he completed his BKB. Now has BOTs and 2,100 gold to boot on top of that. So forget about the Ember Spirit, but this guy, the Invoker, man, he's doubling the Spectre on the other team, who still doesn't really have too much. He picked up a Sanjin Yasha, not the Manta style we were thinking, but... not really sure how the Sanjin Yasha is going to get him back in the game.
It's all about like this kind of race car, chase one hero down and desolate them 5 or 6 times type build up. Like, it's fine in theory for solo pickoffs as a Spectre, which would give you a lot of momentum, but you need to, at this point, you need to be carrying the game. You don't need to be picking heroes off. So the fact that he's, you know, running 465 despite having all the movement speed items he can, like, I don't see him going Yules anytime soon. So he's got all the movement speed he should have, and he's still only running 465. With that phase active, and that's the nerf. I mean, 5 movement speed seems tiny, but when you have all these percent modifiers on it, the Spectral Dagger, as well as all these items, Jao just feels really sluggish, and he's not getting the most value out of what he's been looking for. So, very frustrating for him. Yeah, he's just kind of not able to carry the team on his back, and I just feel like he's overwhelmed by both FCFC and Ketchikimba at this point. The BKB comes out for Ember Spirit. Ketchikimba has obviously been dominant throughout this game. And at this point, I don't know what Rave do to bring themselves back into it. Like, if they had a mechanism, they might be able to take a fight, but we see no mech for either side, and it's so difficult to sustain throughout the fights, and that means just Invasion need to get one good spell combo off.
Yeah, you know, I was just thinking about the lack of mech on Razor, and instead here he invests in the Drum of Endurance, and not a bad item on the Razor, but you've already got one on the Spectre, and yeah, 2 drums is not so bad. The aura is pretty minimal, but that's a value pretty close to a mech, and if Razor had invested in that instead, they'd at least have a lot more effective healing in these team fights. And I don't know if that item alone would have been enough to prevent what happened from
Invasion. Oh, no, Chrissy.
Chrissy comes in, gets off a lasso, but instantly telekinesed, and, well, I guess that's why FCFC pretty happy to be having a BKB right about now. Batrider's dead, no buyback. They'll use chains onto the Swish.
Oh, the melee lasso!
Overgrowth on 3, the meatball flies through, and that's a triple kill for FCFC. Good game from Chrissy. And there you go, that's the follow-up call is Invasion. Take a convincing win in only 29 minutes of gameplay.
ADTR, that's the walk-in lasso from OTEC. You don't often get to see that one there. Well, minor correction there is that Rubik did pick up a mech at the last fight, like literally right as we were talking about it, he did pick up one, but I mean, that didn't really change anything. Invasion Esports, they were already just running all over Rave, and yeah, in this spot, it really comes down to Rave not being able to get their feet underneath them, really. They fought, they had 2 or 3 really, really good team fights. And that was back on the Haunt, maybe when the Stampede was unavailable. They were able to do so much work. But after that, there was just too much finesse from FCFC. He was able to move throughout the fights. He certainly had the support of his teammates. And I think a lot of it came down to the fact that Chrissy got picked off. They needed the Batrider to initiate. Instead, he got counter-initiated on hard. And he had to respect what ADTR brought when it came down to counter-initiation. It just was too quick. And he was, unfortunately, the one feeding his life away more often than not.
Yeah, no argument here on that front. And all around, just a good execution from Invasion. We'll get to see them in one more game tonight, folks. We've got Invasion versus Zephyr coming up next. It'll be getting started in about 20 minutes time, 4:15 on the Pacific Coast. And, well, we'll be excited to get into it. I'm Ziori. He's Blaze. If you enjoyed the cast, consider giving us a follow on Twitter, at ZioriTV, at BlazeCasting, and, of course, at Beyond the Summit. You're watching The Summit 2 SCA by G2A.com, and we'll be back after this break.